Well, joining us now to talk more about the latest pronouncements of Fed Chair Jerome Powell is Steve Cochrane from Moody's Analytics. Steve, good afternoon and welcome back on the program.
Good afternoon.
So we've heard Jay Powell's pronouncements at Jackson Hole, more tightening over a longer period, more hawkish than ever. How do you think this will impact the monetary board decisions across the region, ex-China?
Yeah, Chairman Powell was had a tough tone on his speech on Friday. It looks like not only will they continue to raise rates pretty forcefully, but I think the key factor is that once rates achieve what one might call a terminal rate, and that rate is up to debate, but once they achieve what might be the terminal or peak rate where the Fed is going, they may keep it there for a while, which means that monetary policy moves will likely increase rates through the end of this year into early next year perhaps, but then keep them at that rate through next year perhaps, maybe even a little bit beyond. And that to make certain that inflation expectations remain anchored. That's a key factor for the Fed, and that inflation begins to decline. So what it means for central banks here in the region, in a sense, it doesn't mean a lot because most central banks are already on the policy normalization path, and that certainly is the case for the BSP, which began raising rates in May and has been raising rates steadily since then. And most central banks have. I think there are really only a few laggards, if you can think of, say, Indonesia, that just lately in the last couple of weeks did their first interest rate hike, a small one of 25 basis points, but they were really behind the pack. And then there were others like Korea that were well ahead of the Federal Reserve. So it doesn't mean much in terms of the current path, but what it does mean also then is that central banks in this region may have to keep rates high for a while longer, maybe longer than they expected, at least to maintain interest rate spreads, interest rate differentials at a reasonable path over the next year or so. So rates will continue to go up, but the BSP has already signaled that for the Philippines. And the trick now is the question is how long those rates will remain high.
That's right. So you're not expecting any unwinding soon by the Fed, but do you see a recession coming from the U.S. for sure? Would you say they already are? I mean, technically in recession. What's the likelihood of a recession in other markets, perhaps relevant to the Philippines?
So actually, I don't think you can say that the U.S. economy is in a recession right now. It is true that GDP fell slightly quarter to quarter in the first quarter and the second quarter. But a recession in the U.S. is defined not just by GDP growth, but by how long, how broad, and how deep any economic downturn is. And many, many factors are taken into consideration to make that call of dating the beginning and the end of a recession in the U.S. And the most important factor about the U.S. economy that makes me think that it's not quite correct to say it's in recession is that the labor market is extremely strong. The unemployment rate is at 3.5%, very, very low. Wage growth is strong. Consumer spending is hanging in there very, very well. And so in many ways, I think the economy is still doing fine. I don't think you can say it is in recession right now. Will it be? Well, given where interest rates are going, there is a chance. I would say that if you look at the next, say, 12 to 18 months, you could put perhaps even odds on the chance that the U.S. economy will fall into recession sometime in the next 12 to 18 months. I think the U.S. economy is in better shape than, say, is the European or the and the U.K. economy there. I think recession odds are higher. And a recession might come sooner in that part of the world. It could be in the fourth quarter, maybe the first quarter of next year, particularly when the winter months set in and the very, very high energy prices kick in terms of limiting household spending if more household earnings has to go towards heating bills. And also the costs for industry as well as those bills pile up. So there is a greater chance, I think, of Europe and the UK falling into a recession, and perhaps a bit earlier than there is the probability for the US economy falling into recession.
Mm-hmm. Understood. Well, obviously, the inflation level and economic conditions in the U.S. are not the same as in the Philippines. But do you see inflation for the Philippines tapering off anytime soon? And based on this, what are your expectations for the BSP's Monetary Board meeting September 22?
Yeah, inflation is high, as you show. It's 6.4%. And it's been high. It's been elevated for quite some time. And this is going to be front and center in terms of the BSP's policy decision in September. Given that the BSP has already commenced its so-called normalization policy, but rates are still relatively low, I see that the BSP may very well make another 50 basis point hike in September. Certainly, Governor Madala has expressed his conviction that the BSP will take all actions that are necessary, and particularly the comment that inflation is very broad in the Philippines across so many components of consumer spending, I think, elevates the concern. And then following the 50 basis point hike in September, I wouldn't be surprised if there are further hikes, maybe smaller hikes, 25 basis points following that. I think the key thing in the Philippines is to watch food inflation. I think if you look at top line inflation, we may very well see an improvement soon, much like we have seen in the U.S., where energy prices, petrol prices could very well begin falling. But food prices, I think, are going to be very, very important. The food price, of course, affects so many Filipino households. Food consumption accounts for a very large share of household consumption in the Philippines, and this will be critical in terms of where the BSP is putting its focus in terms of taming inflation.
That's right, Steve. And you also say that growth and our labor market would be continue to be challenging. Economic managers are optimistic this year, especially coming from last year when the Philippines was experiencing the slowest economic recovery in the Asia Pacific region. Now our reopening continues. Moody's GDP forecast for the Philippines has improved to 7.2% this year. But what will Philippine growth be dependent on? What else would you like to see the Philippines aggressively pursue here?
It was pretty easy to be pessimistic about the Philippine economy last year when the Philippine economy was in lockdown for so long, and it, as you say, the economy was in bad shape. The only economy in Asia that performed worse than the Philippines last year was India, where lockdowns were also long and strict and very difficult on the economy. It is a different picture right now. First quarter looked very good for the Philippines. The second quarter numbers began to slow down a little bit. I do think that the opportunity for growth is very strong, given that there's a lot to make up from lost growth over last year. I think a key factor to seeing growth going forward is really to make sure that there's enough liquidity in the economy, that there's credit available to many businesses, both large businesses, but perhaps more importantly, the small businesses that may have either halted operations or slowed down operations and worked down inventory or let people off give them an ability to hire back, to build up inventory again, to go out after markets and to begin to grow again. I think this is going to be a very, very important component of economic growth going forward this year. Just the fact that schools opened up recently, I mean, this is a big, big, huge change in terms of bringing life back to normality and allowing people who may have dropped out of the labor force because they simply had to take care of family to get back into the labor force. They're going to be looking for work. They're going to be available. And there's a matter of simply making sure that there's an ability to hire when that need is there.
That's right. And with the reopening, still lots of potential there. We also saw a sell-off in Asian markets today after Jackson Hole. Should we expect the same for the Philippine Stock Exchange tomorrow? Or How attractive is the Philippine market for foreign investment right now? What do you think might drive sentiment?
Well, near term, of course, I mean, there's got to be a lot of risk given what came out of Jackson Hole and that other Asian markets this year that are open have not been faring very well. But that's to be expected given the strength of Powell's speech on Friday. But longer term, I think the potential is very good. The potential is good for Southeast Asia to be able to absorb foreign direct investment as well as local investment going forward. All of the Southeast Asian economies in this process of reopening its domestic economy. And the Philippines is behind that trend, which means there's a lot of potential just for domestic spending to pick up and grow once again. Here again, as children are back to school and households are going back to their more normal daily lives. I think that, again, the Philippine economy has a very, very good potential to do very well. We think that growth this year, next year, should be somewhere in the low 7% range.
Excellent summary and outlook. Thank you so much for joining us today. Steve Cochrane from Moody's Analytics. A pleasure to have you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
We appreciate it.